Hello, welcome back. In this video, my dad and I have a father-daughter HVAC chat out in the backyard. I had my kids with me, so being inside would have been even noisier than outside. I hope you don't mind the chorus of outdoor sounds as we answer a bunch of really great questions submitted by subscribers. I hope you enjoy our conversation and have a wonderful day.
Question that I wanted to ask you is from Joe here, and he's saying, is there a difference in the feel of an AC slash furnace versus a heat pump when you're inside your house?
Yes, there is. And that's one that we always have to explain because it's a pretty drastic difference. And in the air conditioning mode, they're going to be exactly the same, the heat pump and the air conditioner. However, in the heating mode, when we're using the heat pump to heat the home, the discharge air temperature is going to be much more tepid, not as warm. If it were 90 degree air heating the home, if you put your 98.6 degree hand in that 90 degree air, it's actually gonna feel cool. A lot of times people are puzzled by that, but if you think about it, could we heat your home if all the registers had 90 degree air coming out of them?
Yes.
You kind of go, yeah, that makes sense. But it's actually gonna feel on the cool side. So that's a real important question to have answered before you invest in a heat pump, because that's a big difference. And for some people, that's really uncomfortable. It's kind of a deal breaker.
Yeah, they want to feel the heat.
Yeah.
All right, next question.
Okay.
Derek is asking, trying to solve our issues with a hot second floor. Just curious, if we did install some dampers, would you completely close the dampers or only pinch them back halfway or something?
Well, you're going to do whichever works best for you. I would say, really, before you go to the trouble of installing the dampers to experiment, simply close all the registers downstairs or on the lower level of the home. You're wanting to force all the air, all the conditioned cool air to the second floor. So literally just close the registers, cover them up, do something like that, and you'll get an idea on how well it's going to work or not. The other thing is run the blower continuously. That'll help a lot too.
That's interesting, Dad, because James had something to say about that the other day. I want to see if you feel the same way. He was like, well, but I have heard in some instances where the dampers didn't work so great because they were hadn't done duct sealing.
Mm-hmm.
And so they were just losing so much air anyway that they still had weak airflow to the top.
Good point.
So what James recommended actually is if you're dealing with the hot upstairs, he was like, it might be worth it just to at least do the duct sealing test.
Mm-hmm.
First and see
right. How
much air you're losing. If it's not that bad, maybe installing some dampers would be the best solution.
Well, that's a great point that he brings up, because you know it's not uncommon for us to find when we check ductwork, it's leaking half of the air.
Yes.
And when we say leaking half the air, the half of the air is disappearing and we don't know where it's going
into walls or
so. If you're dealing with a hot second floor, going back to the original question, and you're talking about installing dampers, duct leakage is also a thing to investigate as part of the solution as to why this upstairs is too warm.
Right.
Because we have found duct leakage is way more than what we ever thought it was. When you start talking about losing a half or a third of your capacity to leakage, then it's not hard to understand why I have hot areas in my house.
Yeah. I was out on a duct ceiling with Brendan a couple of days ago. And I was there for the pre-seal test, and they were losing 47%.
Yeah, that's not uncommon at all. 30 to 40%, 50%,
yeah.
Not uncommon.
Afterwards, he got them down to like 0.6%.
Yeah.
And he had found a huge hole behind drywall that was like the size of what a register would be,
going
to nothing.
Right.
Going nowhere. He had to get into, he was like, he got it down to where it was like 6% duct leakage, and then it wasn't going lower, and he was like, there's got to be a
there's
huge
still
hole
something
somewhere.
Going on. Right.
And
Brendan's
so,
very good at
doing
the detective work to figure that out.
Yeah. So he kind of like feeling along the wall, he found where there was pressure.
Mm-hmm.
And so he was like, I think that there's a leak right there. He opened up the drywall and there was a hole behind the drywall in their ductwork, just like this big.
What a loss. What a waste. It's incredible.
So he sealed it up and got them down to nothing.
The level of customer satisfaction. The other thing is, you know, here we will solve the 30, 40, 50% duct leakage and the level of customer satisfaction when we're done. I'm not aware of anyone, not having their expectations met.
Okay, next subscriber question. This came from one of our more popular videos about when your air conditioner is leaking water, different reasons why. In it, we mentioned pan treatments. So Pete is asking, is it okay to have water on the pan in the first place? Is it bad that you need a pan treatment, maybe? Is that what he's asking?
Well, it's just an interesting question. It's a good question, and it depends on your drain pan. If it's an older unit, many of the pans were just stamped steel, and so they were flat on the bottom. Rarely did water completely drain out of it, you know, so you would always have a little bit of water sitting stagnant in that drain pan. And that's where they, yes, it's very beneficial to have,
that pan treatment.
Some of the newer coils are now a plastic material, and they have a molded bottom. So they will actually put a slope, they will build a slope into the bottom of the drain pan. So if we just get it level to begin with, the water, it holds very little water when it's not in use. And so it just depends on what the pan is made out of. But no, it is not uncommon for them to hold water. And both are, it's both very beneficial to have the pan treatment installed.
Next question, and this is a long question. I'm just gonna read it out completely for you. When is it time to get a new unit? I have a 1993 central air unit. Because of the age, technicians automatically wanna sell you a new unit. I know anything can be repaired, but there is a time when it's simply best to replace. One other thing, when a central air unit fails, it's like having only one car, you're stuck. I don't want this to happen, so I'm looking for options to improve house airflow. I have a whole house fan, recently installed a window unit, and I am looking at installing additional airflow options to take advantage of an 1,100 square foot house that stays relatively cool most of the time. However, the current heat challenges will make anyone scream for mercy. So this question would be a great video. You guys seem to be honest and ethical, but not everyone is. So what are your thoughts on replacement time and diversifying options to ensure you can no longer be stuck without air?
Really good questions. He's thinking about it, and that's a very good approach to have. When is the best time? Because who wants to buy a new air conditioner?
Right.
Nobody. But he is addressing.
And if it's 93, he's probably taking really good care of it.
I was gonna say congratulations.
Yes.
You've obviously taken care of it.
Yeah.
He's bringing up several points here, and let's talk about some of those. One is, you get to choose when it gets replaced. You know, you can do that. And the air conditioner is only going to fail when it's in use. So you need to think about that. You know, it is going to be an inconvenient time. If you just wait for it to die naturally, it is going to die at a very inconvenient time. It's going to be when you are needing it, when you're using it. Now, to what extreme or what extent? Most people don't want the surprise of, oh, today's the day. Today's the day that we begin the 2 or 3 days without cooling. So you need to weigh that. And I don't know what the situation is, or what, do we have small children in the home? Do we have elderly people in the home? Or how sensitive are we to the heat? But most people, when they're using the air conditioner, they're needing the air conditioner. And so you need to take that into consideration. If you're faced with a repair or something like that, again, no two repairs or two situations are the same. You just have to weigh and say, gee, do I want to spend $100, $200, $300, $400? What is the threshold of what would I be comfortable with in putting money in this old air conditioner? Because depending on the unit that you have, we might be looking at, gee, I know these are going to fail. And when it fails, this is an expensive repair to have to go through. So I hope you have a trusted HVAC technician who can give you some real honest, you know, we don't want to be caught short here because parts are hard to get. Or you might have something that's very mainstream and parts are very readily available and it's not that big of a deal.
Like maybe have somebody out and take a look and get some options just so that you know, so that you'd be aware.
And certainly off-season pricing should be advantageous then.
What do you think about his idea about diversifying cooling options?
Well, that's where he's kind of lost me just a little bit as far as airflow, because we've also had some questions on ducting, and it almost sounds like he's having trouble heating or cooling, rather, his home certain times of the year or when it's at its extreme.
Well, right. I don't know if he has that because it's uncomfortable or if he just wants more options.
Well, it sounds like it's not cooling at time right now because it's a very extreme condition. That's when, you know, we were talking about duct sealing earlier, where a typical duct system is going to be leaking 30, 40, 50% of the air. Well, when is that going to show up? Mm-hmm. It's going to be when we're at the extreme, when we need 100% of the system performance. True. At times of the year when we need 100% and we're losing it, that's when it's going to show up. So that's almost what it sounded like to me. So that system needs some diagnostics, because regardless of how hot you think it's getting, it should cool your home. You know, you should be able to reach your desired temperature setting, regardless of what the weather is outside.
Okay, another damper question. So I've noticed one damper. It has a summer and winter indicators, like, written on it. I opened the area where the damper is, and when I turn the lever, it closes for summer and opens for winter. Should it be the opposite? I asked this question because it's summer right now, and I noticed my upper floor is getting hot while the damper was set on summer. Should I just keep it open and then close it for fall, winter?
It depends on where that particular duct, where that damper, which part of the house is it servicing. That's what dictates whether you open it in the summer or close it in the winter. Not all dampers want to be open in the summertime. You know, we're wanting to close off the lower levels of the home. So now, not that it couldn't be marked incorrectly, you know, so if you're seeing a very different result when you adjust the damper, it's very possible that no, this is the summer setting,
right?
This is the winter setting. The hottest part of the house is where we're wanting to send the cool air, so that's when we're wanting to open the damper. All other areas we want to close off, and yeah, I could even say completely close off if you can. Mm-hmm. We want to force as much air as possible to those upstairs. Typically, it's the upstairs if it's a two-story house. Yeah, there is no right or wrong answer on how is it marked.
Okay, so this is a question on, we made a video where I just made a video showing a complete air conditioner installation, but it was only on the outside part of the house. Mm-hmm. So this person's asking, I assume this system supplies the entire house with cooling. How are the indoor units, or is there a central one with air channels in each room? And then they said, thank you.
Nice. Well, it is a central unit. It is a singular, you know, most homes just have one central system. Sounds like kind of maybe confusing this with a mini split type air conditioner that has multiple blower sections inside the house. But what you saw us installing was a one central HVAC system. So there's one blower in the system, one duct system, and then we split it up from there.
So this might be a good time to ask, can you explain the difference between central air conditioning and the ductless system?
Well, the ductless, as the name implies, does not have a duct system.
Ductwork, yeah.
So it has little cassettes, they call them, inside the house that is a blower. So that would be, if you put one in the living room, it's going to just put air in that space, in that living room. And you'll have to have multiple of these blowers, cassettes, to go wherever it is you're wanting to introduce cool air. Whereas the central system has a duct system, that one duct system, one blower, but it's being distributed throughout the house. And so that's why we install dampers and things like that, so we can control at what rate is air being introduced to those different parts of the house. So
we install mostly central air conditioning or HVAC units. Mm-hmm. Is there an advantage to just installing ductless systems? So, like, I'm just thinking back to that one guy's question, because, like, if one room goes bad, do you lose all the other rooms if you're doing the ductless mini split system?
Typically not. They're operating independent of one another, unless something happens outside.
So the outdoor unit, then they're all gone.
They're all gone.
Yeah, okay.
And, but, you know, we've done videos from, remember, we were on vacation, and it was an older Florida home. That running ductwork would have been extremely difficult to do. You know, there was no headroom, you know, and it had multiple cassettes inside the house, and did a really great job. And for that situation, those were really good solutions to, we'd like to heat and cool this home in, like, the modern era now.
Yeah, putting air conditioning maybe in a home that wasn't built with that in mind.
Right. No, that's exactly what this was.
Yeah.
Most homes in our area do have duct systems already installed and that sort of thing. Not to say we haven't installed mini splits to be able to heat or cool a room or a general area might be short of capacity. It's a great way to bolster whatever system you have in the home by adding a mini split. So
I was kind of surprised, though, that they're not less expensive than a central.
Yeah.
Are they more expensive, do you think, or kind of just
Yes,
they're on par.
They're on par, and if you're talking about multiple systems in a home, that can drive up the cost as well.
Okay, thanks, Dad. Mm-hmm.